Coming up on this episode of DL Weekly, Rise of the Resistance opens later this week. Good ticket deals for 2020, 80s night details.
A lot of new food options, a Disney item auction. We talk about tips for experiencing Rise of the Resistance and more. DL Weekly starts now.
Welcome to DL Weekly, a podcast about Walt's original Magic Kingdom, Disneyland. We cover the latest news and information from the resort, test our skills at trivia, and have a discussion about the parks every week. We invite you to send in your feedback and stories. Our contact information can be found at dlweekly.net. Now sit back, keep your hands and arms inside the podcast, and enjoy this week's show.
And welcome to this episode of DL Weekly for the week of January 15th, 2020. I'm Teresa Urban.
And I'm Tig Bushman. We'd like to send a shout out and a big thank you to all of our patrons for supporting the show. This support helps make DL Weekly possible. Our patrons get some pretty nice perks like access to our Discord chat, live shows, some DL Weekly swag, and more. If you'd like to learn more, head on over to dlweekly.net/support.
Well, if you're going to go to the park soon, maybe for Rise of the Resistance opening later, and want to be wearing some DL Weekly swag, head on over to dlweekly.net/store to pick some up. There is still our winter and holiday logo versions available on the shop if you are feeling festive about the show and want to show it off in the parks or anywhere, really.
Well, it is that time of the month where we get to draw names out of our patrons to get to be an opportunity to be a guest on the show. So for once, I'm saying it. So you got to do the drum roll.
So just a reminder, guys, you get to either choose to be a guest on the show with us, or if you don't want to actually be a part of the show, that's totally okay, too. You get to choose our next discussion topic, too. So drum roll.
Oh, there she goes. All right. And it's Melissa Van Leuven. I hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. Congratulations for getting picked out of the patron Mickey ears.
Now let's get to the news.
Well, this Friday, January 17th, is the official opening of Rise of the Resistance at Disneyland. We'll cover this in more detail later in our discussion topic, but some quick tips. Make sure you download the Disneyland app to get a boarding pass for the attraction, and open the app to join a group as soon as you're through the turnstile.
This is so mind-boggling to me. I said to Tag when we were going through creating the script for this week, that it's just so crazy that we've been talking, I feel like we've been talking about, it's coming. It's amazing to me that it's here. It's this week.
Well, now we get to start looking ahead to next summer, where we'll have Avengers Campus. Yeah. And then we get to look towards the next one, which will be Mickey and Minnie's Runaway Railway. Mm-hmm. There's a bunch of stuff coming.
Yes. And I feel like this year especially is going to just kind of feel like a whirlwind of news, because mm-hmm. it seems like there's so much happening.
Yeah. I'm just thinking that 2021 is probably going to be a big focus for Disney World, because that's their 50th mm-hmm, anniversary. Mm-hmm. So I feel like Disneyland will kind of chill out for 2021. Yes. But it's good that we're getting some stuff this year. And then, of course, on the other side of it, we'll be getting Mickey Minnie's Runaway Railway. So, but I'm with you. Like, January 17th felt like it was so far away. And really, from the time Rise of the Resistance opened out in Hollywood Studios to now, seems very quick. So.
I know.
Crazy.
Well, Disney announced this week that R2-D2 will be a permanent fixture rolling around in Batuu over at Disneyland. We reported previously that R2 is being tested in the land. However, testing must have gone pretty well. This is crazy exciting to me. It's such a small little detail that they're at. I mean, in the grand scheme of Galaxy's Edge, just a little blip, but
sure.
Such an iconic character. And mm-hmm. I just think it's so cool to be able to walk around the land and see droids like roaming around and interacting, especially ones that we know and love.
Yeah, I'm hoping that they get some more. I think we talked about this previously, that mm-hmm. it'd be cool to get, you know, like little BB-8 or something
yes.
rolling around too. Or even just some other like R2-like droids
yeah.
rolling around.
Yeah.
I know James and I have been watching. We were behind 3 weeks on Star Wars Resistance, the animated show.
Sure.
And there's a bunch of droids in that one. There's one called Bucket, which is kind of funny. He looks kind of like R2, but it's like you can see his insides.
Oh.
Like it's just kind of a frame. Mm-hmm. And he's wearing like a pilot bucket on his head.
Funny.
And it like wobbles around. It's very cute. But I could see something like that. I like the idea of this, and I'm hoping that they put more, because I think the atmosphere of the land just needed some like characters and stuff moving around. Yeah. And so droids, I think, is the easiest way to do that because you just have them roll around. Mm-hmm. I'm interested also to see some more characters as time goes on, because right now we have Rey and Chewbacca and Kylo Ren and some stormtroopers. But it'll be cool to see R2 and whatever else comes next in the Star Wars universe, I guess.
Yeah. It, you know, the thing that I think this, it's a very simple addition, but it brings that motion to the land that it was kind of lacking a little bit, kind of like, I know, I feel like this is, we go over this all the time, but kind of like what Tomorrowland's lacking a little bit too. So I feel like
just that kinetic energy.
Yeah, there's something, you know, something going on. There's some movement. So I hope that, like you said, that maybe they'll be able to get a couple more droids to come hang out in Batu. BB-8, of course, like you said. Mm-hmm. But I was also thinking about what that the new one from the newest movie. I don't remember like what the, his little, name like, is. One he is the thing? Cutest little, yes, the cutest little thing.
Dio.
Yes, Dio. Super cute. So maybe he'll come join the fun too.
Well, there's also a droid, BD-1 from Jedi Fallen Order, but I think that one would be harder because it's, you know, it's really short and it's kind of like a two-legged thing. It's not like a wheeled kind of situation.
I would love to see, of course, C-3PO. I don't know how that would work.
I mean, technically, he's in the movie, so like, why wouldn't he be?
Yeah, but I don't know how that. Like,
it'd be a person.
They'd have to have a person, but I don't know how like how costuming would work for that person in the costume.
Well, that's how it worked for the movies.
That would be awesome.
That's true. Well, for guests living in Southern California or kids anywhere, there are some good ticket deals for 2020. Now through May 18th, Southern California residents can purchase a 3-day, one park per day ticket for $67 per day or $201 for the whole ticket. Tickets are limited to 5 per person that qualify per day and are the same for children or adults. For families outside of Southern California, children ages 3 to 9 can get the same $67 per day, 3-day, one park per day ticket. Both ticket offers include one magic morning.
Wow. That's amazing. That makes me wish that I was a Southern California resident and like had family visiting or something.
You have an annual pass now.
No, I know, but like it, but I'm saying you could very easily take a group of people for a really crazy low cost for Disneyland tickets.
Yeah, 201's not bad.
No, for 3 days?
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
The only thing is one park per day. However, they do allow you, there is like an upgrade option. I don't know how much it cost. It didn't really say on the website, but you can add the park hopper option to this ticket. Of course, that's going to make it a little more expensive.
You know, but like we've said before, I think thankfully there is getting to be enough stuff over in Disney California Adventure that it does feel more like a full day park. So I think even if you did the one park per day, it's a crazy good value.
Do you know something really interesting? Like, I've realized this. So I follow a bunch of different Disney people on Instagram.
Sure.
And I've been realizing lately, to my surprise, actually, that people have been kind of favoring California Adventure. And I found it really interesting because, like, they might pop into Disneyland for, like, one or two things, but then they spend, like, the rest of the day in California Adventure. And I found that weird because, for me, like, if I had to pick one park, I'd pick Disneyland.
Oh, yeah, me too.
But I think that, like, people that have grown up with California Adventure, like, just like we grew up with Disneyland, they don't have the nostalgia with one park over the other.
Sure, sure.
So, and if you like more thrilling attractions, you're going to pick California Adventure. So,
well, and they've been getting a lot of great food and fun drinks over there. Plus, there's entertainment. There's a lot going on in California Adventure that didn't used to happen.
Do you know what's fascinating? And this is kind of off topic. Surprise, surprise. But I have been. We have a service that allows us to download books or read audiobooks, and it's like all included for like a monthly fee. And I've been listening to Bob Iger's biography.
Oh yeah,
and it is fascinating because it covers. I'm about 2/3 of the way through the book now. And I just want to keep listening because it's fascinating to me. So it starts out with him talking about like how he got his start in work in general and working his way up through ABC and all these things that happened and people that tried to dissuade him. And then like when Disney bought ABC, he came in with that. And then having to work with Michael Eisner and then like all of the drama that happened. I didn't know a lot of this drama happened with Michael Eisner on his way out and Bob Iger on his way in as CEO. Sure. And they are right now in the timeline of things. We were talking about Disney buying Pixar and how Pixar was actually moving away from Disney.
Yeah.
And Steve Jobs, who was running Pixar at the time, did not get along with Michael Eisner. And so like there wasn't going to be a deal. Well, then Michael Eisner out of the picture, Bob Iger actually got a friendship with Steve Jobs and kind of brought it back to the table. But I'm interested because I feel like we're getting to the point where they're going to start talking more about the theme parks in the time where, like, okay, so they opened a bunch of different things. And one of the things that they need to fix is when California Adventure went under that big remodel, they spent all that money to, like, renovate a lot of stuff. I'm really interested to see his, like, behind the scenes on that. What sucked me into this book, and I don't want to, like, totally be stuck on this, but, like, I just think it's such a great book, and I don't know where we would talk about it, but I think it's worth a listen for anybody who's a Disney fan. But the beginning of the book, if you get the audiobook, and I highly recommend if you can find the audiobook somewhere to listen to it, he reads, like, the first section of the book himself, and it talks about how he was trying to open Shanghai Disneyland at the same time that the Pulse nightclub bombing happened, and they were trying to make sure that no cast members weren't part of that, which there was a cast member that died. And then right after that, and the reason I remember all this happening is because James and I had gone to Disney World for the first time, and the week after we got back, the Pulse nightclub thing happened, and the kid got attacked by the alligator. So he talks about how he had to deal with that, and at the same time, he's trying to shepherd in the grand opening that same month of Shanghai Disneyland, which had been like 15 years in the making of them trying to make this park happen. And like he couldn't let that distract him, but he had to like address it. It was just so interesting how he like handled it, and him reading it himself is just cool because it feels like he's telling you about this experience himself. And I just thought, it was really good. I didn't know much about Bob Iger, to be honest. Like, we've seen him at D23 and I've seen him do some like, you know, some presentations on things, but I never was that interested in him, like Walt or Michael Eisner, that were kind of like, you know, the face of the company. But like learning his background and all the stuff he had to go through to get to where he's at, like, I thought it was amazing. I could talk about it forever. I highly recommend, if you have the chance to pick the book up or rent it from the library or something, I would suggest reading it because it's very interesting how there's a lot of behind the scenes things that like you don't really hear about or like don't know about. He talks about deal making and how just like weird circumstances happen to make things. So basically with this Pixar thing, if they didn't get Pixar back under their umbrella, Disney would not even be what it is today.
Right.
Because the way he said it was their animation division drove everything else they did in the business. And they were having, their animation division was not doing well. And so Pixar was doing really well, but when their relationship was separating, Pixar would have overtaken, it was scoring higher and everything for families than Disney was, which is like amazing to think about, but not surprising if you think about it. But so like if Bob Iger did not mend that relationship and bring Pixar back into the fold, Disney would be a totally different company than it is today. It wouldn't have been able to buy Marvel and Lucasfilm. And so,
yeah, they kind of touched on that, I believe, in the Imagineering story, but then there was also a couple of different shows on Disney Plus that I watched. And the one was Waking Sleeping Beauty. I believe they talk about it. They talk about Pixar, you know, the kind of the relationship with Pixar, you know, the ups, the downs, and like how different everything would be without it. So it's fascinating. It really is.
So it's interesting to see like the executive side of it, I guess. So sorry for going on and on, but really good book. I would recommend any of you guys picking it up if possible because it is very interesting. If you're into business, it's also very good. If you're into Disney and the Walt Disney Company, also very good. And you get to hear a lot of cool things about Michael Eisner and how that kind of went and how, you know, everything. So
side note, have you watched Waking Sleeping Beauty?
No, I need to.
They follow Michael Eisner and you like watch.
Oh,
like,
that could be cool.
Yeah, they like go into like a boardroom meeting and you kind of follow him for parts of it. And then obviously it's then the animation stuff too. So I think you like that.
I definitely need to watch that
It goes like completely along the lines with the Pixar.
Yeah.
And the animation stuff, it goes along the lines of what you were just saying there. Well, tickets are still available for 80s night over at Disneyland for their After Dark series first night. It's going to be January 29th. The party goes from 9 p.m. to 1 a.m. with early park access starting at 6 p.m. The event includes specialty food like Sloppy Joe Burgers over at the Red Rose Tavern, photo opportunities with themes like Tron Mouser Size, The Little Mermaid, and more. The Fantasyland Theater will return to Videopolis with a VJ playing music videos from the 80s. A special fireworks show, Awesome After Dark, Fireworks to the Max, will also premiere. Of course, merchandise and more will also be available. You guys cannot see me. I have the biggest grin on my face because this just is just like dripping with 80s to me. I love it.
I was so excited that they're doing a fireworks show
for it. Yeah, to the max.
Well, yeah, but like the fact that they're adding fireworks, because the other nights have not really, they've just had like either normal fireworks or no fireworks. So I thought it was cool that they're doing a fireworks show that's going to be to 80s music, of course. So I'm curious when, I'm wondering if they're going to have some type of special World of Color thing, because the Villains Night's in California Adventure. So I think that would definitely be like a value add for these type of tickets. Mm-hmm. The fact, obviously, Videopolis coming back, we talked about Videopolis in a previous episode. And so it's cool that they're bringing a lot of this stuff back. Tron, Mousersize, Little Mermaid, Photo Opportunities. You know, I love the 80s. I grew up, I was born in 81. So it's cool to like have this thing. I kind of wish I could go to this, but not in the cards this time. Maybe they'll have another 80s night down the road.
I don't know. So last year was 90s. This year's 80s. You think we're going to do the 70s next year?
Wouldn't it be so cool?
Disco Mickey?
If they got down to the 50s and they just had like, they only opened the attractions that were there like opening day, or like just Fantasyland. You know, it'd be so
maybe,
cool.
Maybe.
Maybe they'd have a character of Walt Disney walking around. Probably not, but that'd be interesting. Well, the Disney Parks blog has released the Foodie Guide to Lunar New Year 2020 at Disney California Adventure. Some of the notable or interesting items include a black sesame mochi donut and a Vietnamese cold brew with coconut milk at Longevity Noodle Company, a mandarin orange and green tea tart at Lucky Eight Lantern, shrimp and ginger dumplings with soy reduction and sriracha mayo, and of course, my favorite mention of the purple yam macaron with creme fraiche at Red Dragon Spice Traders. You know me and macarons. I'm just
one of these days you're gonna be able to try this macaron, because I feel like you talked about this exact macaron last year.
Probably. But I, you know me and macarons. It's a texture thing, right? Like it's just a texture thing.
This looks so. On the long, long list of Disney bucket items to me, hanging out for the Lunar New Year is one of the higher ones. In fact, when we were looking at news articles and putting together the script today, I started looking at jobs that were in California so that I could just move and be able to do all of these things whenever I wanted to, instead of having to get on a very long plane ride to go do all this stuff. So yeah, it's just, there's just so many fun and exciting things, and we haven't even talked about half of them yet, but just so many fun and exciting things that just seem to always be going on. But this food looks so fun. It's beautiful.
I still have the problem with their food, though, because a lot of these things are limited just to the event, which is good in a way, because that means we keep getting fresh options. But at the same time, it's kind of sad, because like we've talked about on the show before, what if you find something that you just love and like really want to have? Like for me, we had a couple times when we were in the park in August, we had those bao buns from the Tropical Hideaway. Mm-hmm. What if that was a limited time thing? Like I'd be devastated because I want these things.
But the nice thing though is I think Disney's smart, right? They figure out what's popular and they bring back the popular dishes.
That's true. Yeah, I was surprised with this. Like, I thought that this cold brew looks good. These donuts look really interesting. Of course, like, this is just so colorful.
I think that's the mandarin orange and green tea tart.
Yeah. So if you guys want to see this and get some mouthwateringness, we got a link in our show notes to the foodie guide. Just looks so good.
It just looks so pretty.
Look at the colors on this. I think this is this mango mousse is like such a vivid color. I just love the colors. The colors are great. Mm-hmm. I don't know if the food, like that was one of the things I liked about like the Pixar Fest cake, was that it was all colorful. Yes. And they had an electrical parade one that was all colorful. Big fan.
They tasted delightful too. So
you know that if Teresa is using the word delightful, that it's got to be good, right?
I've been really good. I haven't said that for quite a while.
maybe.
Well, speaking of festivals, new details have been announced for the upcoming Food and Wine Festival. This festival takes place February 28th through April 21st over in California Adventure. Signature events that were announced include a bunch of winemaker receptions, so kind of bear with me. So there's a winemaker reception with Skywalker Vineyards at Carthay Circle Restaurant on March 20th. Another winemaker reception with Fess Parker Winery at Carthay Circle Restaurant on March 27th. A third winemaker reception with Silverado Vineyards at Carthay Circle Restaurant on April 10th, and a winemaker dinner with Silver Oak at Steakhouse 55 on March 18th. There's going to also be a beverage education and tasting seminar, multiple seminars, one on beer, wine, and mixology over at the Sonoma Terrace and Golden Vine Winery. However, we do not have dates listed for those yet. Something else new that's this year is that select downtown Disney locations will be getting in on the Food and Wine Fund too. Locations will be offering festival-inspired food and beverage options along with their regular menu items.
So I'm going to give you a trivia question right now. Do you know who Fess Parker is?
I do not know who Fess Parker
is. Fess Parker played Davy Crockett.
I was going to say, do you know who Fess Parker is?
I couldn't think of his name. All I was thinking was the coonskin cap. But it was funny because you were going through it. I was like, oh, yeah. So, you know, if you like wine, obviously Food and Wine Festival is for you. So it's cool that they're doing this. I do like the fact that Downtown Disney is also getting in on it with inspired food. So if you're a local and don't necessarily want to go into the park, you could still kind of partake in this. I think that's smart for Downtown Disney too.
Yeah.
Get more people out there and kind of part of it because, you know, why shouldn't they be involved in it?
Builds the excitement.
I wish I had more money, Teresa. Potter and Potter Auctions is holding an auction that will feature Disney collectibles gathered from theme parks around the world with an emphasis on the Haunted Mansion and Adventureland items.
Oh, perfect.
Theme park props and cast member souvenirs. There are over 750 items, including posters, costumes, and uniforms, signage, original drawings, blueprints, animation art, park maps and memorabilia, and much more. The auction takes place on February 8th, but prospective buyers may place online and absentee bids in advance of the sale. Check out the link in our show notes to see all of the items. There is all types of stuff at this auction, and I tell you, man, there's always stuff. Like, I just can't believe that Disney doesn't hold on to more of this stuff. I mean, I guess some of it's cast member stuff that, like, was given out, so there was probably a lot, but whew.
Yeah, there's resort maps, there's different posters, it's just tons and tons of stuff. Old, you know, trio of Disneyland Park booklets with maps. Just some stuff that I'm sure is just in great condition that people have just been hanging on to and collecting.
Yeah. Wouldn't you like to, like, get some of this stuff?
I feel like I've said this before. I would just like to walk through this auction and treat it kind of like a museum.
Sure.
Just to see all this stuff. Because, I mean, it's fun to see all of the different things online, but it would just be so much more fascinating to me to be able to be, you know, like, this close to it, looking at all the details on all of these different attraction posters and memorabilia.
Well, some of this stuff, you know, it's just one of those things, like, I feel like I'd see a lot of this stuff, like, in a gallery, like the Disney gallery, you know what I mean? As like antique things, but they're offering it here that you could bid on. Of course, you know, I mean, I think the lowest thing I saw so far has been $100, or $80 has been the minimum bid, but they expect things to go, some of these items, quite high, so... should be pretty cool.
Well, the newest popcorn bucket that has landed at the resort is pretty cool. The new Millennium Falcon popcorn bucket can be filled with popcorn or French fries. To get the bucket filled with fries, guests must order it through mobile ordering at the Galactic Grill. Not only does it look cool and hold a couple of different food options, the engines also light up. The bucket is one of the largest offered to date. Guests can pick one up today for $24.99 while supplies last over at the Galactic Grill or popcorn stands in Tomorrowland.
So I saw this online this week, and I saw that, like, the little engine lit up, and I saw it, and I was thinking that it was probably... let's say 12 inches wide.
Maybe like a dinner plate size?
Yeah, like a dinner plate size. And then today when I was looking at this article, it is huge. And in fact, if you look at pictures of it in context with some other things, like they had some picture, well, they had a picture like on a table, but that's hard too, because then you're like, well, how big is the table? But I saw a picture.
Just look at the guy, like this photo of the guy holding the bucket. Look at his hand compared to it.
Yeah. So, but I saw a picture somewhere else that had this like neck, like on top of the like outdoor vending cart.
Sure.
Like it was sitting like the display for it. And I was like, this thing is huge. You could fit so much stuff into it. I just, the biggest thing for me with this is the fact that like the engine lights up. It's so silly, but the engine lights up. I'm also surprised that they don't sell it in Galaxy's Edge. Although I guess it doesn't really go with like the actual thing of it all.
It's not in universe really.
I suppose, but still. still. And it looks like it can hold a lot of fries. It's cool that they're opening it up so you can get like something like fries in it as well. I don't know. Do you want one of these? Would you get one of these?
This honestly is probably, in my opinion, one of the cooler popcorn buckets that
I've
seen.
Like Oogie Boogie?
There's been some really, really cool popcorn buckets, but this one could be easily a display piece.
Sure, sure. The only thing I'm a little concerned with it is it seems like the plastic that's made out of is a little light. Like, I wish it was a darker plastic to be more Millennium Falcon looking.
Sure, color-wise.
Mm-hmm. Like, the painting or whatever could be a little different on it. But maybe otherwise, I think it's cool.
Maybe it's a new Millennium Falcon.
Oh.
It's before.
Well, they should have made it white, like when Lando Calrissian owned
there
it.
There you go.
Well, in a move that should surprise nobody, there's another new churro flavor. This time, it's a new Fluffernutter churro. This new, what?
The name. Yeah. That's great.
This new treat is available at Willy's Churros on Buena Vista Boulevard and is a classic churro covered in a peanut butter drizzle, marshmallow drizzle, and chocolate chips.
Ah, hence the name Fluffernutter.
Right. This actually looks good. I would give this a chance.
I don't know if I'd say drizzled. It's smothered. There is so much stuff. It's covered. I don't think of all the other churros we've seen. Like, sure, it will be like, you know, just sugar is the only everything. But usually when they say drizzle, it's just a little bit. You can't see the actual churro through all of the toppings on this thing.
Shh.
What? Why are we sheen?
Because it's just, you know, it's probably like 1,000 jillion calories. But
oh, I'm sure it is.
It looks really good. Like, I would actually try this one.
I feel like I'd have to eat it with like a fork and a knife, though. I think it'd make a huge mess if I tried to eat it like a regular churro.
Well, they give you like double the tissue paper for it. So this actually is one of the few churros, because you know me, I've always been like, I kind of want to stick with the classic churro. I would order this one.
I would try this one.
Maybe it'll be there when we're there in April.
Can we share it? I don't think I can handle like a full one on my own.
I don't think so either.
Well, for those of you like... That's exactly what I thought about this thing. It looked like a fancy Pop-Tart.
Yeah, right?
Well, for those of you that are fans of Pop-Tarts, there is a new item over at the Jolly Holiday Bakery on Main Street that's very reminiscent of a Pop-Tart. The strawberry ham pie, which apparently is another way to call, you know, like a Pop-Tart, has a flaky soft crust filled with strawberry and is covered in purple icing, themed sugar sprinkles, and white chocolate snowflakes. This is the most beautiful Pop-Tart looking thing I've ever seen in my life. I feel bad comparing this to a Pop-Tart because those are just ugly, right? And they don't taste that. I mean, they're okay, but I have to believe that this is like, yum.
So I saw the thing, they said a strawberry hand pie. I'm like, what the hell's a hand pie?
And I
started scrolling down looking at the pictures. I'm like, it looks like a Pop-Tart.
Yeah,
and then I got down, I was like, oh yeah, it's a Pop-Tart.
I feel like other times I've seen hand pies, they looked, I don't know, they didn't look as square and frosted like this. I could be completely making that up, but I have seen, you know, the Disney food blog especially do reports on other hand pies. Maybe it's because they haven't been as colorfully frosted in the past, and I didn't as much remind me of the Pop-Tart.
What intrigues me about this one is they said that it's better than a Pop-Tart because this one, the crust melts in your mouth with each bite, and you can taste all of its buttery goodness. Because a Pop-Tart, like, just tastes like sugar.
It's kind of, and the crust is kind of cardboardy.
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
It's just sugar filled with sugar inside of cardboard.
So, if this is still there when we're there... We've apparently got quite a large budget going on.
We're starting our food list already.
Jeez. We did so well the first time. Well, a treat from last summer has returned to the resort for this season. The sour cherry beignets are available at the Mint Julep Bar again. You can get a set of 3 for $5.49 or a set of 6 for $8.99.
Okay, I am like, I don't know why, but I oddly really want to try this. Because I don't understand how these two things go together. So I really want to try and see if I can understand.
So this is another one of those things for me that's like the churros. Like, I just like normal beignets.
I know. So that's why I'm trying to figure out how sour cherry goes with a beignet.
The Disney food blog has a picture of one like torn in half, this beignet. And like, it's making my mouth water. I want a beignet so bad right now.
So maybe we just opt for the 3. We're not going to commit to the 6.
Nope.
Well, if savory is more your thing, Award Wieners in DCA also has a new treat. The asada fries are thick-cut film strip fries covered in marinated carne asada, yum, cheddar cheese, cilantro, onions, guacamole, and salsa de arbol. Basically, they are nachos with fries instead of chips.
I never thought to put salt, nacho stuff on fries, but this sounds amazing. I love carne asada. It looks like they put a nice big helping of stuff on there.
These fries are crazy. They almost look more like thick cut onion rings.
It's true.
Would be the best way I could visually describe these for you. They're kind of like curly fries on steroids.
Yeah. Yeah. It sounds really good though.
Mm-hmm.
Something you would try?
I would try a bite of it. I don't know if I'd commit to the whole plate.
Sure.
Something else we can share.
Well, this next one, I know you get excited with these. Continuing the rollout of buttons available to annual pass holders for mobile ordering, Docking Bay 7, Ronto's Roasters, and the Milk Stand in Galaxy's Edge has joined in the lineup. So
we're doing this.
A mobile order to get some of these things?
Yes, we're going to mobile order. That is the one thing that I keep forgetting to do is to mobile order to get some of these pins, and you guys know how much I love pins.
Mm-hmm. And these are free when you mobile order.
They are. I know we didn't talk about this one, but they have a Jolly Holiday Bakery Cafe mobile order button.
It's cute with the penguin.
Super cute. It looks like the stained glass that's there, and it's the penguin, little waiter penguin.
What's the guy who plays, it's Benedict Cumberbatch. They had a thing with, he can't say penguin.
Oh, he can't?
No. So he had a whole thing where he was saying penglings.
Oh.
He called them penglings. Oh. So, sorry. Every time I think of penguin now, I think pengling. But, yeah, I mean, why wouldn't you? I think it's smart for Disney to try to encourage people to use mobile ordering by kind of, like, giving them that, like, carrot of
a
free
a little
button.
Bonus. Well, we wanted to remind listeners that It's a Small World is closed this week and will reopen on January 17th. The Mark Twain is closed until January 31st. Snow White's Scary Adventure is closed with no reopening date as of yet. The Haunted Mansion goes down on January 21st until sometime later in the spring. And finally, King Arthur's Carousel is closed starting January 21st, also with no reopening date. But good news, January 17th, Rise of the Resistance will be open.
Yeah. Yeah, but that's going to be interesting. I'm very interested to see that whole situation.
Yeah.
But, of course, Snow White's Scary Adventure, like, that's undergoing its big rehaul. Of course, coming up, we don't have a date yet still, which is why it's not on this, but the Indiana Jones Adventure is going down for its rehaul. So I'm just hoping when we're there in April, I hope Indy's still open because, you know, Indy is, like, my favorite. If not, you know what I think we have to do? I know it totally breaks with tradition. But when we go in the park the first day, I think we're going to have to go to Tomorrowland and do like Space Mountain first. Because we always go left and do...
I don't know how I feel about that.
I'm just saying.
We could just go a little bit further left. Like I had to do my first day.
Sure.
Back when we were there for Pixar Fest.
Okay.
And I just went past there. And I think we went to maybe it was... I don't remember if we ended up doing Pirates first or Haunted Mansion.
Hmm.
I almost
both
like that
choices.
Plan a little bit better because I feel like the secret's out with going left first and hitting up Indy first because the last couple times I've done that, the line's been like almost back up to like the Dole Whip stand. So I think the word's gotten out. Or we could just go get a bao bun right away. There's that too.
I don't know if that's really
a breakfast
thing.
Bao bun. Maybe they have a scrambled egg
version.
Know
that
there's
chimney,
an idea.
That breakfast chimney that Vern had was pretty decent.
Yeah. He liked it.
Well, I think our first stop, I think Rise of Resistance is still going to be busy. I think our first stop is going to be boarding pass.
Yeah,
I mean, we'll probably not get to go right away, but like we have to get in the
boarding pass right away, for sure.
Well, now we take a trip to Trivia Land where producer James tries to stump us with Disney trivia. He'll read us a question, we'll attempt to answer him, and then James will give us the correct answers after the discussion topic. So what do you have for us this week, James?
Well, I'm giving you a warning right now. There is a bonus question this week, which is a throwback question because someone gave us some more information about a question I've previously asked already.
Ooh.
So we'll see how much you paid attention from a few months ago.
Not very much, because apparently I asked a question that you had already asked when I did trivia last week.
Well, we'll see if your memory is there then. But our first question this week comes from listener Matt J., and he asks, what is the name of the pathway that heads into Critter Country just past the Haunted Mansion in front of Splash Mountain?
I know that the walkway by the Matterhorn is Matterhorn Way and Small World Mall, but we're talking about Critter Country.
Yes.
I'm going to say zippity-doo-dah way.
Whether or not that's the right answer.
Yeah, right. That's my brilliant. Vote.
Where is this again?
It is past Haunted Mansion in front of Splash Mountain.
That's a pretty good guess.
Yeah, I'm gonna go with trees on that. It's my best guess.
Bear way, or I don't know, maybe bear country themed. I don't know.
All right, our second question comes from listener Greg M. And he's curious about the animals inside of Pirates of the Caribbean. And if you could name the animals that are featured throughout the attraction.
All
like,
of them?
Like just the species?
The different species of animals.
Okay, so we got a dog.
I mean, I can't guarantee pig. This is an exhaustive list.
I like
but
how you're chicken. Going backwards through. I was going to go like
dog,
from
pig,
the beginning
chicken.
To the end.
How your mind works, right?
Yeah.
Dog, big,
okay,
pig,
so
chicken.
I'm going to go from the beginning. Seagull.
Oh, yeah.
Are there alligators in the bayou?
I don't remember seeing any,
I think
but
there
could be.
Might be... feel like there might be one alligator. Do fireflies count?
Oh.
they were not on my list.
Okay.
But
I'm putting it on there, firefly.
You can celebrate that one.
There is an octopus.
Oh, it's a parrot. Now, there's an octopus. Mm-hmm. There's a parrot.
There's
or
a
multiple
parrot.
Parrots.
Mm-hmm. Chickens.
I got chickens.
can't forget
pigs,
the chickens.
Pigs, dogs. Oh, there's a dog. Is that a donkey or a mule?
Mm-hmm. Oh, mule. Yes.
It's a mule. How are we doing?
Are there cats anywhere?
Where did I see a cat?
I feel
there's
like
a cat
maybe
somewhere.
There's a cat.
I don't know if it's in that attraction, but I'll put cat. But we'll put we don't lose points for putting stuff
maybe,
that's not in the attraction, do we?
Maybe it's
I
one
mean,
of the Disneyland
within
cats
reason.
That's hanging out.
You can't so just start listing like every fish. Animal. There's a capybara and a giraffe and a rhinoceros.
Capybara,
rats.
Geez.
I don't think there are. That would be a good thing, a rat.
There used to be... Was it blackbirds or something? Like, as you were going back up the waterfall, there was some type of bird.
I believe Disney calls rats mouse, like the year of the mouse.
Oh, yes, yes. Very large mice. Very, very large mice. Okay, sorry. Back to this. I don't think there are rats, by the way. That would be in theme, but I don't think there are any. Lots of chickens.
Lots of chickens. Or hens. I don't know if that is the same thing. Do you, if we say
chickens is good.
Chickens
is good.
And rooster?
Dear Lord, I think just chickens.
So they're all chickens, but the females are hens and the males are roosters.
Okay.
So
I'm sorry that I don't know farming lingo.
Oh, boy.
Good thing I grew up in America's Dairyland.
Yeah. Anything else?
I don't think so. Okay. I feel like we may be missing something. Do you have to be able to see them?
Crabs.
Yes, there are crabs. Good job.
Because they're
like, yep.
Yeah, I would call them as visual needs. Okay. So
I was thinking you can hear like ribbits of frogs and stuff when you're in the bayou, but I don't think you actually see any.
I don't think so either. So, but good thought on that one.
Okay,
just like we thought the guy was playing a banjo, but
that's
he's not.
True. I just love that. Like,
did we look at that? Oh, that was since we were there, right?
Always.
We learned that since we were there.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
When we go
it's
back.
It's one of those things that, well, no, we looked up a photo and we're like, oh my gosh, like it's crazy to me that you just assume he's playing a banjo.
Sure.
And he is not.
It's
love it.
It's like what you always say. You get so distracted. Mm-hmm. You're focused on. Yeah.
Yeah.
Good old Mandela effect.
Yeah.
All right. Our third question comes from Ryan H. And we're continuing our answers of lists.
Oh boy.
He's provided me with 4 attractions that have been relocated within Disneyland. Can you name them?
Relocated.
Within Disneyland.
Within,
oh,
yes.
The King Arthur Carousel.
Yes.
The teacups.
Didn't Dumbo get relocated too?
Dumbo. There's 4?
You gave me 4, yes.
King Arthur, teacups, Dumbo.
The Astro Orbiter didn't.
Astro Orbiter, because
it was
well, it depends. It's because it was up on
it
top as the Astro Jets.
Yeah,
and then,
it was called something different. We'll count it. We're gonna count it. I don't know if his list counts it, but we'll count it.
I'm trying to think. Is there anything else? I don't think so.
I asked for 4. You have 4.
Okay.
Are you gonna change your mind?
King Arthur's Carousel, because it got moved back.
Mm-hmm.
And the teacups were also, so
shifted.
The teacups moved.
Mm-hmm.
Dumbo, I think, also moved because the pirate boat used to be where it's at. And then the Astro Orbiter came from the top of the thing to the front of Tomorrowland.
Mm-hmm.
Because I don't think anything else has moved.
Are you sure the Matterhorn didn't?
Oh, wow. I mean, the look on Tag's face.
Wow. Okay.
We don't count the train because that just like the track shifted. That's not like moving the attraction, right? No.
We will not count the train.
Okay. Okay.
All right. Question number 4 comes from Gretchen D. In Fantasyland, there's a statue of the white rabbit between Alice in Wonderland attraction and the Alice-themed restrooms. He's holding a pocket watch because, of course, he's late for a very important date. But what time is it?
Oh, boy.
2:00.
A.M. or P.M.?
It doesn't matter. It's 12 hours or anything.
I'm going to say noon. I have no idea. No idea why, but I'll say noon.
All right, and our bonus question week, the throwback. On April 10th, I asked this question of this year, but we have some more information. So on Monsters, Inc., in the factory scene, there is a plaque on the wall saying how many days they've been accident-free. How many days is it?
I remember you asking this question.
Why is this a follow-up?
Because we have information of why this number was chosen.
Oh, so it's not zero.
Is it like
the year that it opened or something?
No.
Would you like a hint?
Sure.
It is very relevant to the college that Walt Disney attended.
That doesn't help.
That is a great eye roll take.
It could be like the address or the year.
What college did he attend?
Pomona College.
Oh, it doesn't help me either. I have no idea. Big question mark.
The only number that's in my head right now, and I know it's wrong, is 364. And I'm thinking of the scene from The Nightmare Before Christmas. It has nothing to do with anything.
We know where your head is. It's cool. So, well, we'll check back in when the answer is this week's trivia after our discussion topic this week.
Well, for our discussion topic this week, we're talking with Eric from our partners over at ConciEARS, and he is here to talk with us about what everybody needs to do to be ready for Rise of the Resistance coming to Disneyland. So thank you for joining us, Eric, and welcome to the show.
Hey, it's great to be here.
Now, some of you might think Eric's voice sounds a little familiar, and you are right. Eric is kind of the unofficial voice of DL Weekly. He is the voice that you hear every week, and you hear our intro on it. So thank you again, Eric, for doing that and being the voice of DL Weekly.
It was super fun, and I'm happy to have given some service to the podcast here.
Awesome.
Well, we appreciate it. So for those of you who have listened to our podcast, you've probably heard us talk about ConciEARS before, and we're just going to do just a really quick thing about ConciEARS. And for those of you who don't know, Eric, will you kind of just tell the audience what is ConciEARS and what do you guys do and what can you guys offer to our listeners?
That's right. ConciEARS is your magical vacation concierge. That's where we came up with the name. It's a concierge with mouse ears. So we're your travel partners to work together with you and your family to really design the best vacation for you. We take a lot of the work out of your vacation by taking all of that planning, all of the tickets, all of the hotels, all of the dining reservations, all of the fast passes. We do all of that for you, and we do it for exactly the same price as if you had just bought these things directly from Disney and did it all yourself.
That's amazing.
Yeah, and for those of you, I'm sure you guys have all heard us talk about it. They helped us with our trip in August. They're going to be helping us a little bit with our trip in April. James over there was great at getting us our hotel room, which was like a bucket list item for me because I wanted to stay at the Howard Johnson for a long time, and he was able to get us a great deal on that. Of course, dining reservations were all taken care of. So I'll tell you, if I had to take care of some of these things like the dining reservations and stuff, especially if you're going to Disney World, Disneyland's a little easier, but Disney World, you really have to do a lot of planning. Mm-hmm. And so I think the next time I go to Disney World, I'm just going to contact you guys because it's so much easier that you guys can deal with the FastPass pluses reservations and the dining reservations and all of that stuff. So it's a lot easier to have you guys do it. And if it doesn't cost anything extra, why not? Right.
Well, yeah, that's why I work for ConciEARS now. I started out as a customer, a client myself, where my wife and I did a whole bunch of vacations through ConciEARS and developed a relationship with them. It really is a great way to go around it. I've done vacations myself where I've spent all the hours looking through dining times and trying to make all the reservations. And I've gone through big box travel agencies where you kind of give them a list and they say, okay, well, here you go. You're done. ConciEARS keeps following up with you through the entire process. You can text them while you're there at the parks and say, hey, can we switch our dining reservations to this? We just walked past Lamplight Lounge. We want to go there. And they'll do it. I mean, you've got somebody who's on call to help you.
That's awesome. So one last question for this is, obviously people listening to this podcast are interested in Disneyland. Of course, you guys do things with Disneyland. We already talked about Disney World. What are some of the other properties that you guys handle?
So outside of the East and West Coasts, we also book vacations to Aulani in Hawaii. We do all of the Disney Cruise Line options. We can also book your trip to Disneyland Paris and nice. The hotels there. And as you know, there are plenty of hotel options right around there. Mm-hmm. The Adventures by Disney option, which, I mean, if you've never really looked at that, a lot of people don't know about Adventures by Disney. Take some time and look through their offerings. They've got these amazing travel packages around the world, and it's really, really interesting looking stuff. I can't wait to find some time to do one myself because they really look incredible.
Well, I mean, people obviously like Disney for their quality and like their commitment to guest service and everything. So imagining basically taking that same Disney level quality of service mm-hmm. and putting it into some type of, you know, dream trip to, I think I've seen stuff for like safaris in Africa. I've seen things for like European trips and stuff mm-hmm. like that. So basically, and correct me if I'm wrong, Eric, but Adventures by Disney has stuff almost any type of vacation you could possibly think of. They probably have something similar, at least, to what you want. And then, of course, you get that great Disney quality of service and customer service and, you know, just that quality.
That level, yes.
Yeah,
yeah, you're absolutely right. In fact, as far as vacations in the Disney properties are concerned, they're actually the highest rated in guest satisfaction out of all the Disney vacations. So you consider a great stay at some place like the Grand Californian, you think, wow, I can't get better than this. The Adventures by Disney vacations are actually rated higher. So
wow.
They have all sorts of options. They even have options in the US. They'll have a tour of Broadway in New York.
Ooh.
You can go see, you know, Frozen on Broadway. You can go to Montana and visit Yellowstone in winter and take guided tours on a snowcat through Yellowstone, which I can tell you is they don't allow very many groups into Yellowstone during the winter.
Sure.
And then they've got river cruises in Europe and themed holidays around Christmas time in Germany. They're like you said, they've got safaris in Africa. They're everywhere, and it's a really immersive experience where they've got more than just a standard visit to a town, and maybe you get to walk through and see a good restaurant. They'll take you into that restaurant and introduce you to the chef who has a special experience there for you, teaching you how to make pasta. You know, they have everything covered.
Wow. Teresa just freaked out and clicked on, there's one for
We're
China.
On the website now, Eric, because we're looking at all the different things. We're looking at the adventuresbydisney.com website. There's Asia, Africa, Australia, but there's also China, Japan. I mean, anywhere you want to go.
It's scroll back to the top here.
Wow.
12 days, 27 meals,
and you
and
get
16 sites.
Just this is the China trip.
Oh, and you get to go to Hong Kong Disneyland and Shanghai Disney Resort.
Sign me up. Oh, sign me up. We may need to talk about this after we're done with this.
Oh, no.
You can spend hours on that site looking through because my wife and I have.
I believe it. I totally believe it. Wow.
So that's why you want to contact ConciEARS and let them scroll around the site for hours and
let James bring you some ideas. Yeah.
Yeah. There you go. So for those of you listening, if you want to book a vacation to Disney anyway, contact them at ConciEARS. And sometimes we've actually gotten a couple emails about this. It's ConciEARS. So it's ConciEARS, like Mickey Ears. .com, and they would be more than happy to handle anything you guys need for any type of Disney travel, with the exception of the Asia parks, is my understanding.
That's right. Yep.
because those are not actually fully owned by Disney. So,
correct. Yeah, Disney still has a controlling interest in Disneyland Paris, so that's why they're still on the list. And
sure,
everything else is all Disney.
Awesome. So, the meat and the potatoes of this discussion: Rise of the Resistance. So, what do people need to know if they're going? Not even this week, because this week, like, it opens on Friday. But what do people need to know for going, I would even say, in the next few months? Because this attraction is going to be busy.
Yes.
Probably for the next year, at least, I would guess.
Oh, yeah. I mean, in the last few weeks in Hollywood Studios in Florida, they're still using this boarding pass system that you might have heard about before. And I know you've talked about it a little bit on the show.
Eric, can you remind us what the boarding pass system is? Because I feel like Disneyland, they were going to roll it out for Galaxy's Edge, but then they didn't need to have it in place as long as they did. So I think some people may have forgotten what exactly all that entailed. So what is the boarding pass system?
Oh, yeah. And I got to use it in Disney World when I went to the opening of Galaxy's Edge. So it's basically a virtual queue is the way they put it. And it's very different from the traditional FastPass system. Mm-hmm. Essentially, once you get into the park, make sure you have the app ready to go. And with your valid ticket, once you scan that in and you're in the park itself, you can go into the app, join the boarding pass system, join the group. It will give you a number based on when you signed in. And throughout the day, you just go about your day after you've signed in, and it will eventually contact you and tell you it's time for your boarding pass to join the queue. So say you walked in and you got boarding group 11, you'll see throughout the day groups 1 through 5 are boarding, groups 5 through 8 are boarding. Mm-hmm. Eventually, when it's your time, you have a window where you can go in. And that window is fairly large. It's not like you have to drop everything and run across the park to get there. But you might want to, from what I've heard about Rise of the Resistance. I don't know.
Sure.
But that's basically it. Once your boarding group comes up, the app will notify you. So make sure you've got your notifications turned on. And you can go over. They'll look at your app and make sure that you're in the right boarding group. And you can get in line. And it's basically saving you the time from standing in a line for 3 or 4 hours, where you can stand in line for 30 minutes, get through the entire queue experience, because I hear that's amazing. And you can spend the rest of the day walking around the park, enjoying things, eating churros and Dole Whips, and enjoying other attractions instead of standing in Galaxy's Edge from dawn until dusk.
Yeah.
I think this is such a great idea.
Oh,
and it amazes me that, I mean, maybe we had to wait for technology to get there, but it amazes me that this hasn't been figured out before now, because this last summer, over in Universal Florida, they had that new Harry Potter Hagrid's bike ride open, and they had 7-hour waits that were going from the attraction, which is kind of in the back of the park, to the front gates, and people were waiting in that. So can you imagine? Well, and my personal experience at Disneyland when Indiana Jones opened, there was a line down Main Street.
Yeah.
So they had that whole queue that you would actually be queued up in the attraction, the outdoor queue, all through Adventureland, out of Adventureland and down Main Street in the morning.
Yeah.
And you'd wait in that, and it'd be hours.
Yeah.
So,
well, just think of Pandora.
That too, yeah. And well, that was people just trying to get in the land. So yeah, I think that this is awesome that they've come up with this system. So when you utilized this in Disney World, did it seem like it went pretty smooth? Did people seem to understand how the system worked? Did it seem like people were following kind of the rules of the boarding group system?
When I was there for the opening of Galaxy's Edge, this was for the opening of the entire area instead of just one ride, but there were cast members everywhere to explain the system to you. I saw people downloading the app for the first time with some help from cast members, and really all you have to do is have the app ready to go, and once you log in, there are actually pretty good instructions on the app on how to get into a boarding group and how you'll be notified. They had different signs around Hollywood Studios at the time as well that actually displayed the boarding groups that were currently heading in. Once your boarding group came up, you get the notification on your phone, on your device, that tells you it's your time to go. And really all I had to do was show my boarding group to cast members as I was walking up, and they waved me through. I didn't see any problems with people trying to like force their way in. You know, occasionally you see people who seem like they don't quite get fast passes.
Sure.
And the cast members will wave them past. I didn't see any of that happening. It was maybe even clearer than fast passes, because it was so simple. And because they grab like multiple boarding groups at a time based on how quickly people were getting into the area, or in this case, how quickly they're getting through the attraction.
Very cool. So say pretend Tag and I are going to teleport and we're going to be there this weekend for the opening. Since we're in the same party, do we both have to log into a boarding pass from our phone on our app, or are you able to do that just on one phone?
Well, it's just like with your fast passes. So in Disneyland, I'm sure you've had this experience where you've gotten in with your entire party and you link your tickets or your annual passes together with the people that are in your party. You can get into the same boarding group. Just make sure you've got one person who can kind of coordinate the whole thing and do that initial login for everybody. So if this is your first day in the parks, just make sure as you're getting ready to go in, you scan everybody's passes and you're ready to go. Because there is a little bit of a time concern. You don't have to do it as soon as the park opens, of course, but the boarding groups do seem to move pretty quickly. They're filling up.
Mm-hmm. I'm curious, like we've talked about with FastPass before, I'm kind of curious what their like numbers are. I feel like for the first, you know, few weeks maybe, or few days at least, that they might be a little conservative with the amount of people they put into different boarding groups because of the fact that, like, if there's, you know, downtime or whatever, they don't want people that come in at the end of the boarding group to get mad and be at City Hall yelling at everybody because I got here at opening and I was in boarding group, you know, 159, and, you know, it's the park is closing and they only got to boarding group 120. And so I feel like while they're trying to work a lot of things out, they might be making those boarding groups a little smaller, like less people in each group. And then as they get up to speed and the ride is, you know, run through its paces, I feel like it'll be one of those situations where they'll either add boarding groups or they'll make the boarding groups bigger or something like that.
I have some friends who have been to Rise of the Resistance on the East Coast. I haven't been out there yet myself, but some of the experiences I've heard is you'll see the boarding groups move quickly at first, and then it'll maybe slow down a little bit, and then they'll release another large chunk. I know when Mike, our head concierge, and his daughter went just a few weeks ago, they got into the park pretty early in the morning and logged in, got their boarding group ready. And they basically hung around the park for a few hours. They didn't get into the attraction itself until about 2 p.m.
Oh, wow.
Sure. Yeah, I think, I don't know, like I said, I think this boarding group thing is good. I know we had talked previously on the show about how it might be interesting to do no standby line for an attraction. I feel like this is definitely how that would manifest itself.
Yeah.
Is that it would be some type of like a boarding pass kind of system. I do wonder going forward, I know this is not really related to the Rise of the Resistance opening, but it just gets me thinking. I do wonder if in the future to, especially at Disneyland, to kind of reclaim some space, that they might try to thin some queues out to be able to make room for strollers or more people or whatever. And so they might go with more of a fast pass only or a boarding group only kind of thing.
I hope not.
Yeah. Well, then it becomes more like Disney World, right? Where things are more, you have to be planned and you have to make sure that like you get that early. And because like when James and I went to Disney World a few years ago with FastPass Plus, by the time the morning starts, like they have some things available in the morning, but a lot of it's you got to pre-book in advance with your hotel room or whatever, 60 days or whatever it was. And so, and of course, concierge can help with that, and you don't have to worry about that in Disney World. So
very true.
What do you guys seen in the booking industry here for booking people's trips. Does it seem like this opening, are there a lot of people that are coming for this opening of this attraction to Disneyland? Do you guys think that like there's definitely going to be an uptick in guests at that time? Are people kind of, as they're planning their vacations, are they waiting? Are they delaying their trip because they want to wait and wait for the crowds to kind of go away? What are you guys seeing on that aspect of it?
I think the answer is yes.
So all of it.
there's certainly going to be an awful lot of people there on the first day because we've known about this date for a long time.
Yeah.
It's not like when Galaxy's Edge was first opened in Disneyland where they released the date kind of late, where a lot of people were booking ahead of time, kind of hedging their bets, mm-hmm. hoping that the land was going to open around the time that they were there. We've known this date for months now. So there are a lot of people that have been booking up for a while. And I'm sure there are plenty of people who are booking out later. Disneyland has actually had a fair amount of sales as far as the spring is concerned. So they're really trying to drum up the extra business going all the way into April. But many of the weekends are already starting to fill up. So I imagine we're going to see an awful lot of people here for at least a few weeks. Disney World, even though it's you know, we're getting past the holiday season, it's you're still seeing Rise of the Resistance boarding passes go very quickly in the morning. You know, I know Disney World can accommodate a few more people than Disneyland, but really, both coasts are going to be booked up for a while, I think.
Sure.
So a question that I don't, maybe you know the answer to this, maybe we'll have to look this up, but I was just thinking about, you know, how you want to, you know, the best thing to do is to get into the park as early as you can. So say there's a extra magic hour or magic morning or something that allows you to get into the Disneyland park earlier than the regular ticket holders are able to get in there. Are you able to log in as soon as you get in the park if you're in the park early, or does the boarding pass system go live when the regular park hours go?
That's a good question. I think what I've seen on the East Coast is sometimes they seem to open the boarding passes after the park has opened.
Okay, sure, sure.
And in some cases, they've opened it earlier than they advertise.
Gotcha.
So when they've got a specific posting, they'll actually say, okay, boarding passes for Rise of the Resistance will open at 9 a.m. And people have been seeing it pop in around 8:15. So it probably behooves you, if you're there for an extra magic hour in the morning, to get there as soon as the park opens and start refreshing that app, see if you can get in sooner.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what I've been seeing with stuff for Disney World too, is I felt like Disney World didn't communicate things very well because they had people lining up. They had people trying to get to Hollywood Studios the day that was going to open.
Oh, yeah.
Early. And people, like, their parking lots weren't open. Mm-hmm. And so people were literally just driving around in circles on Disney property trying to wait for, you know, the parking lot to open or whatever. And then, of course, you could get the parking lot would open, but then now you're waiting for, you know, the front gates or the ticket booths or whatever to open, and then waiting for them to let you in. And I know that on that first day, people were being let into Galaxy's Edge, getting into Hollywood Studios, and they were allowing them to book their boarding pass, but then they were being told there is no standby queue. You need to go ride another attraction. You need to go onto Tower of Terror, which we have open, or go into Toy Story Land, which we have open, but don't try to sit outside Rise of the Resistance because you're not getting in without a boarding pass.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I've seen those same stories. You know, it's really, when they're trying something new out like this, it probably takes an awful lot of trial and error for Disney to get it right. And the lucky thing now is Disneyland gets to benefit because Disney World worked out the kinks, just like
yes.
Disneyland worked out the kinks for the opening of Galaxy's Edge itself. I mean, when Galaxy's Edge opened up in Disney World, they already had reservations in place for Savi's Workshop and for Oga's Cantina. They realized we should probably just get reservations rather than having people mill about and stand in line and
yeah.
all the other things they tried in Disneyland.
Yeah, it's not very Star Wars in-universe to have a bunch of lines of people standing waiting for stuff.
Right.
Just get a reservation and have them come back. I like this idea. I feel like the boarding groups and the reservations and stuff, I feel like is a much better system. I don't know why I feel this way, but I feel like it's a better system than what has been working with FastPass for things.
Well, and I just think it's a much better system than just having it standby only and having people waiting hours and hours and hours in the attraction queues and lines and kind of, you know, clogging stuff up. Because I just think about all of the reports, and I thank goodness didn't experience this, but all I could think of with Animal Kingdom when Pandora opened was how some of these people would be waiting in line literally all day and they still wouldn't get into, you know, the area of the attraction, you know, whatever it was that they were waiting to get into. And that's just so much wasted Disney time. So I was very sad for, you know, it was just, I could not wrap my head around that for these people that were doing that. I mean, kudos to them. That's a lot of dedication. But yeah, I just, you know, I just felt bad because, you know, it's just a wasted day, really.
Yeah. At Disneyland, you know, this brings up another point. We were in our chat this week. One of our supporters actually tweeted at us an article about, like, the cost of a day at Disney.
Oh, yeah.
And so we've shared that in the chat as well, and we kind of talked about it. And it's very interesting because they compared it with, like, your bang per hour, basically. Mm-hmm. So if you buy, I'm just going to do easy math, these are not real numbers, but let's just say Disneyland, like a Disneyland one day ticket's like $100, and like a Broadway show is like $200. Well, your Broadway show, you're getting maybe 3 to 4 hours of entertainment for that $200. So per hour, it's like $50 an hour if it's a 4 hour thing. Where Disneyland, you might have a 12 hour day. And so for, you know, $100 or whatever, you're paying less than $10 an hour or whatever for Disneyland. And you get all that stuff. That one of the things that it made us think about too was, not only are you getting attractions like the rides and everything, but you're also getting, like, you know, you talk about California Adventure, you've got the Frozen musical spectacular. Mm-hmm. That's like a Broadway caliber show. You're seeing parades, you've got fireworks, you've got things like Fantasmic, you got World of Color. So really, you get a pretty good value at Disneyland for a day if you're just talking about the park ticket. But it, you know, of course it adds more when you get into things like the cost of food and souvenirs and et cetera, et cetera. But how did I get on this?
I don't know. You just kind of went on your own little side street.
I do
there.
That.
But Rise of the Resistance is great.
There you go. Yep,
exactly.
Yep.
Well, so for those of you that are curious, I do have my Disney Parks app up. Park hours for Friday the 17th, so the day that Rise of the Resistance first is going to open to the public. Disneyland Park is open from 8 a.m. to 12 a.m. Disney California Adventure actually has the extra magic hour that day. However, Saturday, the park is open, Disneyland is open 8 a.m. to 12 a.m. They do have an extra magic hour and magic morning on Saturday from 7 a.m. to 8 a.m. So if you're trying to get on Rise of the Resistance and you have access to either the extra magic hour or magic morning, now we're not saying that you for sure will be able to get your boarding pass when you get in there at 7 a.m., but it would not be a bad idea to get inside the park as soon as you can.
Sure.
Just in case they do open up those boarding passes a little bit earlier. And then again on Sunday, Disneyland is 8 a.m. to 12 with the extra magic hour happening over in California Adventure.
So, Eric, what have you heard, like non-spoilery, what have you heard about Rise of the Resistance? Is this going to live up to everybody's expectations?
Yeah, I've been trying to avoid a fair amount of spoilers myself, but I've caught a little bit here and there without having to watch a video online. But the people I know that have been on it say that this changes rides.
Wow.
You know, it's a completely different experience than anything we've seen before. You know, Flight of Passage, I was going to say Flight of Banshee, but that's the wrong one. Yeah, Flight of Passage is an amazing ride, but I mean, we get it. It's Soarin', but way better. It's Soarin' maximized, and it's an amazing attraction that I mean I've waited in the regular line for that. I've waited 2 hours to get on it. That's great. And you know, when you get off, you say, wow, that's the only time I'm going to do that this trip, but it was totally worth it. from what I hear with Rise of the Resistance, it's even beyond that. It's
wow.
It's storytelling maximized. It's ride mechanics maximized. It's waiting in line maximized. I mean, the things that I've heard about when you get past the main queue, which gets richer as you go through, once you get into the attraction itself, we've experienced this before. If you've been on Flights of Passage, there's this little waiting area. You've seen this in other queues before, like even in Tower of Terror or Mission Breakout, where mm-hmm. you get into a room where you're still kind of in line, but you're seeing more show and it's adding more layers. This happens multiple times on this attraction, and each time there are actors and animatronics adding to the experience. I can't wait to see it, and February 20 something can't come soon enough for me.
Well, yeah, I think is the headliner attraction that Galaxy's Edge needed, I think, yeah. to open. I think it was smart of them to open the land when they did, because obviously I think Disney would have taken a big hit not opening the land until this was ready, because everything else was ready, mm-hmm. just not mm-hmm. this. And I will tell you, I was very sad as a Disney fan, because producer James can attest to this, that the best attraction that I feel that I've ever been on in my life, and I've not been on Flight of Passage, Eric, so I will tell you that, but the best attraction I'd ever been on in my life was that Harry Potter Forbidden mm-hmm. Journey attraction in Universal Orlando. And they also have one now in Universal Hollywood, but I went on the one in Universal Orlando and it blew my mind. Like, I could not figure out how they did it. I thought it was amazing because they did 3D sets, or they did like actual physical sets with projections,
and
they
had a
ride, and they had a ride system that was totally different. Mm-hmm. Like, it just blew my mind. And the theming, like you were saying, Eric, just the queue.
Yeah.
You're walking around Hogwarts Castle. They have paintings talking to you. Like, holy cow. Like, I feel like I'm in the Wizarding World of Harry Potter. And I got off that attraction and I turned to James and I said, I love Indiana Jones and I love Disney, but this is the best attraction I've ever been on in mm-hmm. my life. And so I've been waiting for Disney to respond to this, and it's been a long time. It's been like 8 years since they opened that attraction. So Disney like needs to step their game up. So I'm hoping, from what we've seen and what you've described and what other people have described who've been on this attraction, that this is that thing that raises the bar and Disney can continue to do this, because Disney's great at this stuff. We watched the Imagineering story where they talked about all this stuff. And so I'm just waiting. I'm just excited to enter the next realm of Disney, trying to come up with really cool attractions and stuff. So and hopefully this will redeem Galaxy's Edge a little bit for people. I just hope that it doesn't descend the crazy crowds that we were expecting originally in and Disneyland becomes like really miserable to be wandering around. What do you think?
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, we all predicted crazy crowds forever at Disneyland, mm-hmm. and it didn't really happen. And there was a lot of discussion around that afterward. Then it opened up at Disney World, and I can tell you, in the afternoon at Disney World, it's pretty packed in there. The last time I went was during the Wine and Dine half marathon in November, and midday there were waits. It was busy around Galaxy's Edge. But then, early in the morning, it's just like, well, really, this is one of those big tips that actually does work out at Walt Disney World. If you get there at rope drop, you have the entire park to yourself. You can you can hit all the main attractions without anybody else there, and that goes for Galaxy's Edge as well. But even a few weeks after Rise of the Resistance has opened, they're still using this boarding pass system. They used the boarding pass system for one day when the land opened up in Disney World. That was it. The second day, they abandoned it and just let people walk in. If that's any indication, I think Disneyland is going to remain busy for a while now. I think this is what really everybody has been waiting for.
Yeah, I agree. It'll be interesting because I feel like the tables are kind of turned on this one, because we had the land open first here in Disneyland, and then Galaxy's Edge opened second out in Walt Disney World. So it's interesting to me that we're now second. you know, so I don't know. I wonder if that'll play a part in, you know, did all of the diehards go out to Florida because they just couldn't wait until January 17th? So is that helping us that they open first, or is it really not making any difference? And, you know, we have a lot of annual pass holders and just people that are closer to Disneyland, love Disneyland more, that were waiting for specifically Disneyland's version to open. So I'm super curious to see how this plays out.
Yeah, it's a very different demographic in California. So it's going to be fun.
Yeah. So for those of you who don't want any spoilers, tune out now.
That's me. Bye,
guys.
Tune
out now. Come back in a little bit and you know, for the end of the episode to get some trivia answers or something. But so I know you haven't watched any videos and you've tried to remain as spoiler-free as possible, Eric, but what have you heard about this attraction spoilery wise?
You go outside and then back in and then you go outside again. That, just hearing that, I'm like, oh, what?
It's amazing the small thing. You're like, going outside, that's the big thing.
And then you go back in, but then you go outside.
Alice in Wonderland goes outside. I mean,
right, right.
And back in and back outside.
True. And it's great.
I'm very curious. The little bit of spoilers that I have heard, mostly from Tag, is that it's not one ride vehicle. That's the other thing that's like mind boggling to me, is you're not just getting in like a Doom buggy and you're in the Doom buggy for the entire thing. You're very much part of it because you're actually having to move.
It's kind of like Haunted Mansion in a way that like the shuttle you get into at first is kind of like your stretching room.
Oh, okay.
And then you get into your main ride vehicle later. But like that whole journey is so different, I think.
Yeah. That's crazy to me.
And to have actors actually involved in this, cast members who are acting, is pretty crazy. And like so many things, you hope they keep up that opening day sort of excitement and that engagement and dedication. Mike bet our head concierge, when he was in line, he bet a kid in line $5 if he could make one of the first order officers laugh. And that kid did not get $5.
Oh, it's like the guards in London, the like royal guards or whatever. Yeah. Like you try to make them smile, and they just sit there no matter what.
That's right. Awesome and amazing. Well, and the cool thing to me is, of course, we've seen live actors in a Disney attraction before, in Hollywood Studios, but I feel like these live actors are different because they not only are they, you know, playing a role in the attraction, but they're also there to kind of like make sure you move along and do what you're supposed to do. So they're functional. They're not just a live action animatronic, sure. I guess, for reference. You know what I mean? Like they're kind of dual purpose. I think that's really interesting.
So I'm not going
to. It is.
Go ahead.
Oh, yeah. I was just agreeing. Oh,
I am not going to get into it on the podcast because I don't want to spoil it for people.
Please don't.
But I found a video this week that I loved. And it was about like how all of the cool new effects in this ride are done. And I was like, oh, I love this. Because
see, I would want to see, you're so different than I am. I want to see them in person.
Yeah.
And then maybe find out how they were done. I don't want to know how they were done and then experience.
Agreed. Again, I'm not going to get into specifics and I'm not going to even allude to some things. I'm just going to say there were some things that they pointed out of like effects that they did that from the video I wouldn't have even thought was like I thought I knew how it worked and I like dismissed it because I was like, oh, that's simple. It's just a projection or something, right? Mm-hmm. But there's like so much to it. And I'm just like, wow.
I don't know if I want to ride this attraction with you. I might make sure I'm in a different boarding.
No, no, no.
You're
going
to be like talking my ear off.
What's going to happen?
Oh, look over Teresa. Watch this.
What's going to happen is we're going to ride it. I'm going to be mouth agape the whole time.
Okay, I'm going to duct tape your mouth.
Then we're going to get out and I'm going to be like, Teresa, that one part, this is how they did it. Watch when we go on it again. This is how they did it. Look for this. Look for that. Okay. Did you see that other thing? Wasn't that so cool?
So if you guys are in the park the last week of April and you see me running away from Tag, you know why. You now know.
I'm just saying that Imagineers are brilliant at simple things.
Oh, for sure.
And
the Haunted Mansion, case in point.
It's true. So, Eric, what are you most excited for with this attraction that you've read about or whatever? Like, what is the thing that, like, you're like, oh my God, with this attraction?
Well, I mean, probably the life-size AT-ATs. I think that's safe. Everybody knows that's in there.
Yep.
I mean, we've all seen them on screen. We all feared them as children. I maybe shouldn't admit this, but I was scared of my washing machine and dryer as a kid because I thought it sounded like an AT-AT.
Oh, yeah.
So you had to run past the laundry room if it was nighttime and the dryer was on.
But
just the thought of being in a room with something that enormous, like this is an attraction, and they actually have a real sized AT-AT. We've got like the fake, you know, one at Star Tours in Hollywood Studios. Mm-hmm. That's pretty great. But we know that was designed, that whole attraction was designed to look like a set. You know, you walk behind the trees and it's got scaffolding and it's kind of tongue in cheek, the whole thing. This is supposed to be the real thing. And when you've got stormtroopers and First Order officers walking around and you see an actual giant artillery vehicle, like, wow.
Yeah.
So I don't think this is a spoiler because it doesn't give anything away for the attraction. But one of the coolest things, since you're a Mr. AT-AT fan, the guns.
I'm sorry. I need to stop you right there.
Yeah. Thank you.
Oh, my God.
AT-AT.
AT, sir.
AT-AT. You don't call it the AT-AT?
No, absolutely not.
That's like calling R2-D2. I don't know.
No, they're called AT-ATs today. And right, James?
he's so flustered right
he's
now.
He's just not even.
This is an argument for the ages. I know.
I wish I could.
But I've made a firm stand
for this.
Okay,
here.
So the all-terrain armored transport. When you're in the attraction, there is a part of this where the on the side of the head, the guns like aim at you, like they come down and like lock into fire. Yes. They're in like a parked position because they're in like the hangar.
Yeah.
And as the scene unfolds, it like they tilt down and like aim at you.
So not only are they there, they're functional.
I'm getting chills just thinking about that right now. I'm like a little giddy. So
and you could see the people operating it in through the eyeball, like where their eyes are. You could see the troopers in there.
I can't wait to get into that room because I feel like that room is just going to be colossal.
I will say,
because I know I've tried to remain spoiler free, but of course they've had promo photos and I feel like that is the promo photo that room. And I just, it feels like you're going to like go through like scenes of, well, you could almost say any of the movies, as they always seem to be kind of in one of those hangars with all that stuff. But you know, it's just going to feel like just so large, so much larger than life.
The two things that I see in all the promo stuff is I see that the hangar bay that you first enter into with all the stormtroopers, and then you see that at that all terrain armored transport hangar. And I will tell you that I was slightly disappointed when I saw video because I thought that room from the construction photos we saw of when they were building the AT-ATs out of steel, when you could like see in the building when the building didn't have its outer shell.
I forgot about that. Yeah,
it looked like it was part of that original like hangar where the stormtroopers are. It's actually a different section of the attraction, and that room is smaller than I expected it would be. Like I thought it was a cavernous giant room. Like wide,
it
let's say.
Probably it's feels. Not too bad. I'm sure they worked their Disney magic, and it feels that
way. Well, in that video I watched, there's a way that they make this room seem much bigger than it actually is. But I'm not going to spoil it. Just say it's really cool. This attraction, like I don't know. There's just so many things that like. What makes it a great attraction for me is the fact that like I don't know how they do some of this stuff, and so. That's what made the Harry Potter attraction so exciting for me is because like I couldn't figure out how they did it the first time. So when I've watched these online videos like 7, 8, 10 times, it's because I've been trying to figure out how they do some of these things.
But didn't you just say that you found a video that tells you?
I did just this week, but it's been like a month of me trying to figure out how all this stuff works. Gotcha. And it's been driving me crazy.
Yeah, I'm definitely bringing duct tape.
When you've got a camera angle of somebody vlogging it, I want them. I'm like, look to the right, look to the right. And of course, like the camera's not going to move. So I have to keep trying to find videos that maybe like it would look a little more to the right or more to the left. And it just doesn't happen. Anyway,
You're very passionate about these videos.
This attraction is amazing. That's why I can't wait to experience it. Eric, I'm with you, man. You're going to experience it before we do. So lucky you.
Yes.
Yeah, I guess.
I was like, did he pass out?
Yes. No, I am quite lucky.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I don't know what else we have. I think we've kind of covered most of everything, right? So
yeah,
people need to get the app.
Yeah, big thing. Make sure you have the app downloaded on your phone. And like Eric mentioned, make sure you allow those notifications to come through so that when your boarding group does come up, you don't somehow miss it. So you get, make sure you're getting those app, those notifications, so it, your phone will tell you when to go.
I also saw online, mm-hmm. because I'm sure that there are some people that, maybe not that listen to this podcast, but there are some people that are not as tech savvy and they don't have like a smartphone. You can check in with a cast member and they will get you a boarding group, and then you just have to watch the monitors around the park for when your boarding group is ready. And you could check in with cast members for that,
yeah.
too.
Yeah. The other thing, too, is if you are going with a group, make sure that you have your tickets purchased ahead of time so you don't have to spend time waiting at the ticket booths to get your tickets purchased. And also have your tickets pre-scanned into the app, too. So as soon as you get through those turnstiles, you can be on your phone trying to request your boarding group time.
So producer James put in our chat a link to a Time Magazine article. How do you pronounce ATAT?
I'm with you, Eric. I go ATAT, no matter what any Times article says.
Yeah, I'm not too sure. Is Time really a reputable publication? I don't know.
Fake news. Okay, it says an email blast to Lucasfilm's public relations department provided the definitive verdict. The official pronunciation for ATAT is the phonetic one, as it rhymes with hat.
So now here's my argument. When do they ever say at in any of the films?
They don't even ever refer to it. They call them Imperial Walkers.
Oh, you're right.
That's true. Yeah.
Okay. My argument's been rescinded. I'm taking it back.
Yeah, because they just call them Imperial Walkers.
You're right.
This changes nothing.
And then they call the two-legged ones, they call them Chicken Walkers.
I do not remember them calling him a chicken walker in a movie.
Somebody called it a chicken walker somewhere, but they're ATSTs because they are all-terrain scout transports.
Mm. Yeah, and you don't say atst. Right?
Well, you know, if we were ever going to get a bunch of angry emails from people, it's going to be because of this.
Way to go, Tag.
Glad to be part of this age-old argument. Yeah.
All right, Eric. So is there anything else that you would like to talk about that we did not talk about when it comes to Rise of the Resistance?
No, not really that I can think of without getting even more spoilery. So, yeah, I think we had a good recap on what you should look forward to and what you should be prepared for when you head down.
Perfect. So next thing, I know that you, when we were talking to you before we recorded the episode, there was a couple blog posts or something that you guys had put out. If are interested in reading about those, where can they find those?
Yeah, technically they haven't been posted yet, but they will.
Ooh.
They will go up. Yes. Sneak preview. This is the scoop right here. we've got a description of, It's a little spoilery, but it's a ride through discussion and some of the feelings experienced by our head concierge Mike's daughter when he and she went on the attraction a few weeks ago. And I also have a post going up from another one of our guest bloggers talking about some of the things you should be prepared for when the attraction opens up in Disneyland, just like we've been talking about. So you can refer back to that as well. But our blog is located on ConciEARS.com. So that's ConciEARS.com. And you can join us on the concierge desk, a few times a week when we get our blogs up there. And we generally have tips and tricks about going to the parks. We've got our experiences there. We've got restaurant reviews, lounge reviews, food, drinks. We're kind of all over the place. And we've got a new guest blogger who's going to be spending a lot more time in Disneyland itself over the next few months. New foods coming out and new experiences hitting the parks. Bryce will be right there to document it as it comes along. So we'll be adding a lot more content over the next few months.
Well, that person that is doing your stuff Bryce. For food is going to be, Bryce is going to be very busy because we are always talking about food.
Oh my gosh.
So I hope he has a healthy budget to be able to talk about this stuff because it's going to cost a mini fortune to have him try all this
Well,
stuff.
And think it, hopefully he does a couple extra laps around the park to burn off all those extra calories too.
All right, Eric. So if people want to book with you guys and if they want to get in contact with you, because I know we had talked with you before about Run Disney stuff or if they any of that stuff, how can people best get in contact with you guys?
Well, again, you can go to ConciEARS.com. You can, if you want to give us a call, we've got a toll-free number, 856-687-3277. That's 856 our ears, O-U-R, ears. Or you can email us at service@concierge.com, and that'll connect you with one of our talented travel planners. We've got folks who have been booking vacations to the parks for years. They've experienced the parks themselves. We've got a few cast members, former cast members on staff who know the ins and outs of even, you know, both coasts and even the Disney Cruise Line. So we've got a lot of experienced folks that are at our disposal who are here to help you have the best vacation you've ever had.
Awesome.
That sounds great. Well, we've used you guys. We hope that our listeners will continue to utilize you guys for things. And I really don't see a downside. I don't know why people would not just go through you. Also, I know we say it in the episode all the time, but you also get a free year of touring plans when you guys go through us and mention that DL Weekly sent you. So thank you so much for spending time with us tonight, Eric, and talking about, first of all, ConciEARS and what people need to do to be prepared for Rise of the Resistance opening this Friday at Disneyland Park in Anaheim, California.
That's right. Well, thanks for having me. It's been a blast.
Have you taken advantage of the free year of touring plans yet? Why not? It's as easy as contacting ConciEARS to book your next Disney vacation. James, Mike, and Scott would love to provide you with this excellent service along with helping you plan a great Disney vacation at no additional cost to you. You already know you want to go to the park, so why not contact ConciEARS and get the planning started? Remember, dining reservations start at the 90-day mark, and they can help you with those as well. So the earlier you get started, the better.
Well, did you enjoy listening to this episode of DL Weekly? Do you feel prepared for Rise of the Resistance? There's so many questions. Well, you could support the show for as little as 25 cents an episode. If you want access to the supporter chat, we always talk about it. It's only 75 cents an episode. Please consider joining supporters like Brandon H. and head over to dlweekly.net/support.
Well, now it's time to return to Trivia Land to get the answers to this week's trivia.
All right, let's get right into it. Five questions from the listeners this week. Our first one came from Matt J., who asked, what is the name of the pathway that heads into Critter Country just past the Haunted Mansion and in front of Splash Mountain?
Is it Fowler's Harbor? That's just the harbor.
It is not. It is Millview Lane.
Dang. I like Zippity Doo way better.
I do.
Can
like
we
answer.
Petition for that to change?
Good luck.
Our second question came from Greg M., and he asked you to list as many animatronic animals as you could that are featured in Pirates. And you came up with a great list. I think you only missed one that Greg had noted on there. And you added one or two on there. So seagull, parrot, octopus, a donkey or a mule, dogs, chickens, cats, pigs, and goats.
Where are the goats?
Well, it's not chewing on dynamite, I can tell you that much.
Did you say crabs? Know. I'm sorry. I missed.
He did not add crabs, but yeah. I think you are right. There's that crabs should have been added in there.
So what do we get for points for that?
We'll call it balanced out and a job well done.
So 1 point?
1 point.
Okay.
All right. Third question came from Ryan H., and he said he gave me a list of four attractions that have been relocated within Disneyland. And you correctly named all four
Woo-hoo!
Of them.
Woo!
The Astro Jets, now Astro Orbiters, Dumbo, King Arthur Carousel, and the Mad Hatter's Mad Tea Party. Well done.
Woohoo! All right.
Fourth question from Gretchen D. In Fantasyland, there's a statue of the White Rabbit between the Alice in Wonderland attraction and the Alice-themed restrooms. He's holding a pocket watch because, of course, he's late for a very important date. What time does the watch say it is? It says it's 5 o'clock.
So,
must have been late for dinner.
Quitting time somewhere.
Late for dinner.
So, and our bonus question, a throwback to April 10th from Tara F. When I asked on Monsters, Inc. in the factory scene, there's a plaque on the wall. How many days has it been in the Scream factory since the last accident? The answer is 47. And why this is relevant, because we didn't know this last time. So back, I want to say in the 1960s at Pomona College, there was some tongue-in-cheek study about the number 47 popping up all over the place. And it's super relevant at Pomona. Like there was a year where they had 47 valedictorians. There's 47 towers on a building. There's just this long list. And then it started to really slip into a lot of mainstream media. For example, the TV show Lost, there were 47 people that crashed on the island. And it just keeps on going, including, I think, a lot of references in Star Trek. And so it all kind of goes back to this of, is 47 the number that just pops up the most randomly in pop culture? Who knows? A tongue-in-cheek study still says maybe, but that's how it's related, and that's why it might pop up.
Well, thank you very much, Matt J, Greg M, Ryan H, Gretchen D, and Tara F for all of those questions this week.
So many questions, and so many great questions, too. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
And I've got some good ones already for next week, but I'd love to get a few more added in there as well as the weeks to come. You can send me an email. It's trivia@dlweekly.net.
Well, we'll be back next week with more Disneyland news and information.
So until then, go out and enjoy the parks.
Ladies and gentlemen, Disneyland has now ended its normal operating day. We hope you've enjoyed your visit to the Magic Kingdom and that you'll be back with us again soon.